we got fundraising, capital raising, acquisitions, and we have maybe easy for the next year and easy for the next year. Now, unfortunately in India, that I'm setting the context for this conversation, unfortunately in India, what is happening when people start off thinking about doing a business, the first thing that comes to mind is I should probably go and find an angel investor, I should find an angel investor. And my recommendation to the our finance committee that we should probably look at discussing business as a, you know, business of business. You don't start a startup because we see for you to be funded. What is the way in which you can start a fundamentally strong business that you will be happy with, that you will probably make a lot of money? Not all businesses are likely to be VC funded. Not all businesses will have the ability to scale up in their potential and need not be. Any legitimate business that can generate employment, that can create growth, whatever extent that we're having, is a good business. And that's the conversation that we will have. Yes, we will talk about the amount of capital required, how much we need to get that capital, etc., whether it's easy or whether it's an opportunity. But before we get into that part of fundraising and stuff, I just want to ask each of our panelists to talk about their views about entrepreneurship and getting into business, and especially when aspiring entrepreneurs are thinking about, yes, I now want to start doing a business. What are the first building blocks of getting started as a graduate entrepreneur? What should be the first building and it really look like when you say, oh, I have a set of work, here's what I'm going to work. What are you going to start with that?
And I've seen the
there were, I think, 4,000 people that had come in, and I did meet a lot of their head, both their chest comes, not in a discouraging way, but in an encouraging way, because they wanted to participate in understanding what was happening. That's why that was just so cute and encouraging. So it is phenomenal. But all this is great, because you've got an idea, you've got some validation. Fortunately for both of you, when you started validating it, it started throwing the ball. But the fact that a lot of people still need some money to get some point in, you know, get more money. How do you bridge that gap? What do you do in terms of doing that? VCs are not going to be interested at that stage. Angel investors also may not necessarily be okay. But you will need some amount of money. It may not be enough, but it requires some amount of money to sustain and stuff like that. How do you manage that?
See, you typically can't choose your parents, but you can choose your in-laws. Right, if you have a rich in-laws, probably they would fund you, right? But on a serious note, thankfully my wife was working, right? And we used to be in Delhi at that time. And once we started on taxi for sure, I came back to Bangalore, that's where my parents went, so that boarding dog and everything will be taken care of by them. Right, and I asked my wife who's work in Singapore so that she can earn in dollars and can invest in the company. And she didn't come back till we got our first round of funding. So I used to get the money and I had the complete freedom also. And that's how tax cut should happen.
But that also shows the tremendous amount of conviction in what we do, right? I mean, that certainly deserves an applause for having that. Rajiv, coming to you, I mean, you obviously need a lot of answers. A lot of them are starting off, a lot of them are not ideas. But then there's a big gap in terms of maybe it's 2 lakh, maybe it's 5 lakh, maybe it's 10 lakh, maybe it's 20, whatever that quantum of money. But there is a gap in between. What are the creative ways that you may have seen people overcome that gap in share? Because you may have been to get to a level where I would be able to get that next set of capital. And what that capital will come to the next. But how do you bridge that gap in the idea and how I want to get into that market? What do you think?
I think every business at every stage will always have a gap. So maybe 10 lakhs initially, maybe afterwards. So there have been a bunch of things, and apart from what we've typically seen as regular funding options. One of the things I've noticed is sometimes you're not able to raise capital in one go. So some of the startups, the PCDs, A kind of startups are seen, which probably are more side, some on the B2C side. Okay, they are there on a continuous fundraising. And effectively the founder is probably raising even 3 or 4 small units of capital. And it's very difficult to recall backing the company or from some time. So increasingly you end up seeing more of a capital vendor structure. It starts coming in as a discount to CBC. So that's kind of becoming more prominent if you're not able to access okay either obviously, many people have been undertaking regular job or even providing services or consultancy to keep things going. Okay, why do we? In certain other cases, I think it's more mature. Like for example, Napoli was a problem with. On the case of Napoli as a business group, okay, they started looking at franchising as an important source of income. So, not only were you able to kind of get VC money and actual sales, but franchise you need to be able to do your continuing business. Obviously, at a certain level of scale, we come to a few franchises that are doing good. Another company for Brazil language technology, the family does local language abilities. They won $100,000 prize from all as few friends, and that really helped them make the business work when they go to it. In many other cases, I think people discover that there's something called the PNL. I mean, we are very balance sheet oriented when it comes to money. But I think increasingly founders need to also start looking at simple revenue models. I mean, founders are quite happy that to have companies use their products. But there is the aspect of question actually looking at asking for revenue and then pricing of revenue. So, for instance, if you take this e-commerce as a company called Mart, recently acquired by Capital Inc. They pivoted from an SME model to an enterprise model. When they started out, they were charging around 25,000 or 30,000 rupees a month. Now it took a lot of convincing the accounting team to think that it would actually charge a lakh a month. But today there are clients who pay around 15 to 20 lakhs a month. So to have that courage, go and sell and also get revenue is again another thing which I have seen for the industry.
So, you know, family and friends and all of that, advances from customers, which is a very, very powerful and probably one of the best ways of funding, to be able to get working capital loans, and some of these are aspects. But, you know, one of the things that we've also noticed, alumni angel groups can be a very, very powerful way of funding business ideas that come at all of them. I mean, there are times we see when we go to business plan competitions in business schools or engineering colleges, there are hundreds of people who apply, but maybe one or two of them actually make the announcement, even if their ideas are already good for the rest of the people. And I believe that the biggest impediment to entrepreneurship as a career option for a lot of people is the student EMI loans and the EMIs and the other life expenses that people might need to take. And often there's a very small gap that the entrepreneur needs to take that idea from a concept level and PowerPoint level to the market. Maybe 5 lakhs, maybe 10 lakhs or so. And I've noticed that instead of going to an external source of capital, which is good for the investors and stuff, if institutions are able to mobilize their alumni networks to put in very small amounts of money, I think we will have a very large pool of capital available. I mean, if I needed 10 lakh rupees to start my business, unlikely that anyone of you would find if you don't really know me. But if I go to my institution and say, can 20 of you put 60,000 rupees in, the chances are many people will say yes if I support that. So I do believe that we need as education institutes to leverage our angel investment networks, or sorry, our alumni investment networks for the business. And so, since you are also involved in the policy part, I just want to if I can request you to just elaborate on what are the different kinds of funding mechanisms that are available today, especially from the government side. Because a lot of things that get celebrated in forums like in ETE and the startup forums, effectively the angel investor led kind of funding. But I do believe there are very interesting schemes and grants and all that are available for the
government. I think after the Prime Minister, our year back, he announced the Startup India scheme, just one thing that we did was to increase the funding for any education institutions or Section 8 companies to set up incubators, so they have access to up to 15 crores of funding to establish and operationalize an incubator. And then for any founders or an aspiring entrepreneur who is at the idea stage, the incubators like the Deshpande Foundation's Startup Sandbox is one of the fantastic platforms to have an incubator.
So when we were talking, we had some key investments that we found was okay. So we got started in a lot of startups that are capital intense, for example, hardware related or IoT related, or any device sensor or things like that. So to these incubators, from Indian government, we are also releasing grants to 15 crores over 5 years, which means that every incubator would drop to 10 crores in their incubator, and they are able to invest up to 1 crore in their incubating companies.
And how many such incubators? In this 100 kilometer radius, what are the kind of individuals that they can serve?
So at the moment, within Hubli, we've got one incubator with the Deshpande Foundation that recognized by the Department of Science and Technology, and another one which I'm going to visit is the PDP Engineering College's incubator as well. So yes, we have an incubator, we are about to set up right now.
And how much capital would they provide, and at what speed? I mean, can I go to them and say, you know, I have an idea?
It's a very simple process. From Department of Science and Technology, so we release the money to them as a grant to the incubator. So, in case of any incubator to come forward with a seed support grant, the incubator will get a grant of 10 crores every year. And the incubator is allowed to invest up to 1 crore in their incubating companies. And they can only invest in a very simple process which has to be transparent, where the incubator has to form something as an investment committee. As an investment committee, which is very similar to what we see works.
What would be the state? What would the entrepreneur need to be ready to take a grant from the investment? Can I go through just an idea or only take a product? Or any and that kind of company being funded by this grant.
So unfortunately, as the technology, because of funds that Indian government got to the citizens, is because of R&D sales that we charge to the customers. It goes up to DSP, and again it is actually employed in DSP. So the only precondition is it has to be tech company and across verticals. And the incubator could take a small equity against the funding that they do to these activities, or they could also refer it as a soft loan, often even is not exceeding more than 60% per annum.
So, what are the terms of the loan? Like a startup by definition, it's unlikely to be, it's an experiment, right? You want to not work. So, I take a thing as a loan from this incubator. Is that sitting as a liability on the head for a long period of time, or if it doesn't work out, what happens?
Yeah, if it's delivered as a soft loan, of course, the best case is an unsecured loan. So, the worst case, it would not work, the incubator can write off. But from the department, we release the fund to them as a grant.
So, the rejection balances, but it's not like a traditional loan where if it doesn't work out,
it's a soft loan, right? So, our technology is just an equity. So, we strongly encourage the incubator to make equity these companies so that the incubator can sustain for the revenues that the loan exists that they make. And another scheme that which they also have in startup media under the BD scheme is the incubators of the part of education institution and for student entrepreneurs who have declared placement. Because I'm newly related because in my batch, and some of my friends who told I cannot, I have an amazing idea, but I'm not from the starting point because the optimization of education loan.
Not necessarily or should not be
the benchmark for any kind of thing. Coming back to the point that I asked earlier, what should be the goal in the day of the time? What should be the thing that we are really thinking about when I think about the middle gap now, but a little bit carefully in terms of what I want to do, and as now start becoming that? What are the things that we should go for? Should it be products, should it be customers, should it be building the team, should it be developing, or is it coming to follow?
The most important
will not definitely go out there, not with a girl, but with who and with anyone in the family. Right? If you don't take your family along with you, sooner or later, it's going to come out and take you. Right? So we had to sit with my parents, amuse them, had to visit my in-laws, amuse them, because they got their daughter married to someone who was in a stable job. And now they're waiting to start something, and my parents and all my relatives convinced my mother that I won't be a taxi driver. So I didn't know what my in-laws would really think. So getting the family took a lot more time.
But I think things have changed significantly. And I was really surprised last time I was here in Mumbai. There were, I think, 3,000 people that had come in, and I just meet a lot of people doing the mentoring thing. And I met three entrepreneurs who had come with their parents, both parents had come, not in a discouraging way, but in an encouraging way, because they wanted to participate in understanding what was happening. And I thought that was just so cute and encouraging and beautiful. It was phenomenal. But all this is great. You've got an idea, you've got some validation. Fortunately for both of you, when you started validating it, and it started showing positive. But the fact is, a lot of people still need some money to get from point A, you know, get to point B. How do you bridge that gap? What do you do in terms of doing that? We see the number of investors at that stage. Asian investors also may not necessarily be okay. But you will need some amount of money. It may not be enough, but it will require some amount of money to sustain and stuff like that. How do you manage that?
See, you typically can't choose your parents, but you can choose your in-laws. Right? If you have a rich in-laws, probably they will fund you. Alright? But on a serious note, actually my wife was working. Right? And so we used to be in Delhi at that time. And once we started on agriculture, I came back to Bangalore, that's where my parents were, so that boarding laws and everything would be taken care of like that. Right, and I asked my wife to work in Singapore so that she can earn $1 and can invest in the company. And she didn't come back till we got our first dollar fund. So I used to get the money and I had the complete freedom also. And that's how agriculture happened.
But that also shows a tremendous amount of conviction in what we do, right? I mean, that's what we deserve to the applause for having that work. That's so, Rajiv, coming to you, I mean, you obviously need a lot of money. A lot of them are starting off, a lot of them are about ideas. But then there's a big gap in terms of maybe it's 2 lakh, maybe it's 5 lakh, maybe it's 10 lakh, maybe it's 20 lakh, what is that bottom of money? But there is a gap in between. What is the day-to-day that you may have seen people overcome that gap and say, okay, get to the way in which I'm going to get to a level, then I'm going to get that next set of capital. And what that capital will come to the next set. But how do you bridge that gap between a key idea?
I think every business at every stage will always have a gap. Maybe 10 lakh initially, maybe 2 lakh towards. So there have been a lot of things that now have come what we've seen as better funding options. One of the things I've noticed is sometimes you're not able to raise capital in 1 month.
I have a privilege of moderating this session. This session is about fundraising, capital raising, acquisitions, and we have maybe easy for the next year that we need to think about getting started. Now, unfortunately in India, I'm setting the context for this conversation. Unfortunately in India, what is happening when people start off thinking about doing a business, the first thing that comes to mind is I should probably go and find an agent investor that I should find. And my recommendation would be with our finance committee that we should probably look at discussing business as a, you know, you start a business, you don't start a startup because we see for you to do a network. What is the way in which you can start a fundamentally strong business that you will be happy with, that you will grow to make a lot of money? Not all businesses are likely to be VC funded. Not all businesses will have the ability to scale up in their potential and need not be. Any development business that can generate employment, that can create growth, whatever extent that we're having growth is within the business. And that's the conversation that we're going to have. Yes, we will talk about the amount of capital required, how much we need to get that capital, etc. We will discuss about the rest of the opportunities. But before we get into that part of fundraising and stuff, I just want to ask each of our panelists to talk about their views about entrepreneurship and getting into business, and especially when aspiring entrepreneurs are thinking about, yes, I now want to start a business. what are the first building blocks of getting started as a family? What should the first community look like when you say, well, I've decided to go to the future for a
first, I will give this statement. Whenever we meet with first time members, the first thing I see the excitement for actually the media that everyone likes, or literally the only media that is good. It's a little launch now, so even though the product is great, the first thing that they say is first thing you should have a funding component. So you could see the bias in the media setting where. The first thing that they raise money is successful in the first place. So, the first point of it would be to ask the government and entrepreneurs together. Funding is like celebrating when you raise money is something like the chef goes to the supermarket by the ingredients. He has only celebrated even before he's made a dish. So, it's very, very important that we understand that business. It seems to make sense in terms of the unit economics and the business model itself. So, like I say, that you do it in terms of businesses even before raising money. And the first venture which I built on the coding, we never had this scientific incubator which we never had on the basis of accelerators or SSBC funding or anything. The only funding that we did before I left was.
So, I'm so glad to hear that because our current definition of startups in India is defined so much by the VC definition of entrepreneurship, which is scalable companies that have definitely multiple management teams kind of returns. And that's okay for the VC model. VC model is about taking bets in high-risk companies, and therefore many of them will fail, therefore, make money. The companies that succeed, they need that management teams kind of returns. But the important point that to us in thinking is that there are certain businesses that can be fundamentally strong businesses which may never be able to scale up to that extent that VCs expect them or may not get management teams. And that is important for us to think of those kind of businesses that we will think of rather than just for VC funding and stuff. And the point that you are also making is that VC funding, certainly, though it is celebrated in the media circles, is not necessarily or should not be a benchmark for any kind of success. Coming back to the point that I asked you, what should be the first indicator for them? What should be the thing that we are should be thinking about when we're thinking of either we are now a little bit clarity in terms of what I want to do and what we want to start becoming a leader? What are the things that we should focus on? Should it be product, should it be customer, should it be building the team, or is it a mix of all of those things?
I would say it's always a customer. Always listen to your user if you're going to see company in this company, you all the things that And you need to be convinced that in case if this is the business, if you have reversed as angels, you would be investing for yourself. And I've seen some of the founders who deserve to be a capital website and say, okay, I know this basic rules at this point. And since they only invest in food tech, I want to build a venture that's in the food tech. So the most important which I would really like to emphasize is especially with this generation, it's only in 2017, the whole demonetization era, so you understand that the priorities have changed. And the most important is the first 100 days, the only thing I'll say is that have a MVP and bootstrap yourself and validate if the problem is big enough that you want to solve.
And how important is it to have a problem that is large enough? If the problem is not large enough, then you'll see freedom.
I would say that my first part of
Thank you.